5 features in Clip Studio Paint that you are probably not using, but that you definitely should be. As I mentioned in my previous video, I transitioned from Photoshop to Clip Studio Paint last year, and while I've been exploring the software, I've come across some pretty cool features and I want to share them with you. You might already know or use some of them, or maybe today your brain is going to implode, just like mine did when I discovered these features. And remember that you can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at NettyAxelArt for general art updates and comics and reels and the occasional art memes. Or you can join the mail list family to always be the first to receive news about upcoming content, tips and tricks and other art related content that I'd like to share with you guys. The link for the mailing list is in the description. And lastly and quickly, before we move on, I just want to mention that my comic series about the demonic wonder team Mocha and Damon is now on Webtoons. The series is called Just Damned Business, and I've decided to put it on Webtoons to make it more accessible and easier for people to read online. So if you like comics and demons and you use Webtoon, I will be super happy if you'll consider checking it out. The link will also be in the description, or you can just search for Just Damned Business on Webtoons. And now let's move on and start with the first cool feature of Clip Studio Paint, the Quick Mask. If you also like to use the lasso tool to create selections in your artwork, you are going to love the Quick Mask. At any point in your drawing process where you need to make a selection of a specific area, you can use what is called a Quick Mask. If you go to Select and click on Quick Mask, you'll notice in your layers window that a new layer was created. It almost kind of looks like a regular mask layer, but this is a temporary layer. Now you can pick any brush and start painting an area that you want to make a selection of. By default, your mask area should appear as red. You can, of course, also use the eraser tool to erase areas. Once you've drawn the area you want to make a selection of, you can go back to the Select menu once again and click the Quick Mask option. First, notice how the temporary Quick Mask layer disappeared from your layers window, along with the red areas that you painted on your canvas. The area that was red before has now instead turned into a selection that you can use either temporary or you can make an actual mask out of it by clicking on the mask icon. But Nadja, you ask, why don't I just use the lasso tool? It seems like the result is the same. And why, yes, the result seems pretty similar, but with the lasso tool, you can't use any of your brushes to make a selection. And that is truly the beauty of the Quick Mask, because it saves all the texture from your brushes into your selection. Whether you use the default G-Pen, a soft airbrush, or something completely else, the Quick Mask brings it over into your selection. The lasso tool, well, it can't do that. And we're moving over to selection layers, because they actually work quite a lot like Quick Mask layers, except that they are not temporary. A selection layer simply lets you store a selection inside a layer. To create a selection layer, go to the Select menu and click on Convert to Selection Layer. Now you can, once again, pick any brush and start painting in the area you wish to make a selection of. Just like we did when we worked with the Quick Mask. The difference here being that the selection layer that was created out here in your layers window does not disappear. It's permanent. Once you've made a selection that you're satisfied with, you can turn down the opacity of the selection layer to 0 so you don't have to look at all the green colored area stuff. Now at any point later on, you can reactivate this specific selection by either holding down Ctrl and left clicking on the little layer thumbnail, or you can right click on your selection layer and choose Selection from Layer, Create Selection. Now, when would this tool ever come in handy? Let me show an example of how to use it. Here's an illustration that I'm currently working on. It's not done. I've made it to the rendering process mostly, and have come to a point where I have merged all of the character layers into one merged layer, as you can see out here. I usually merge everything at a much later point in the process, but for the sake of this tutorial, you know, I've done it now. So you can see how the selection layers can be useful. Under my merge character layer, I have a folder full of selection layers. All of these selections are based on the flat color layers that I initially had on this file. So now, even though I'm working from just one single layer, which is the merged character layer, I can at any point now go in and make a selection of a specific area, for instance, the dress. Just in case I wanted to, for instance, change the color of my dress at a very late point in the process. I also use the selection layers if I want to add some effects to a specific area of the character while protecting all the other areas at the same time. And if you don't like the color of the masked area, it's kind of annoying, you don't like green and stuff, you can at any point go to the little colored square here in your layers window and change the masking color for the specific selection layer. Draft layers. Oh, this one is exciting, guys. In Clip Studio Paint, there is a setting called a draft layer. You can turn any of your layers into draft layers if you want to. When you set a layer to be a draft layer, it means that this layer will now be excluded from a number of reference processes such as, but not limited to, exporting your image and using the fill tool. Say you have a layer with a sketch on it, and then you have a layer for the line art, separately, of course. There might be a case where you would want to start adding some colors or tones to your line art, but you still want to keep the sketch layer visible while you do so, for reference or whatever other reason. And let's add that using a reference layer for any reason is simply not an option right now. I'll quickly create a layer here for the colors. Using the fill tool with refer to all layers would mean that it also refers to your sketch layer. As you can see when I try to fill in my line art, we learned about this in the previous video, by the way, the link is in the description. But if you select your sketch layer and set it to be a draft layer, indicated by the little pencil icon up here, the general referencing to this layer is now excluded in the process, so now you can use your fill tool or any other tool using layer references without it referencing to the sketch layer at all. One way that I use the draft layer is for all of those little notes that I save for myself. Sometimes I'll use a layer as a guide for myself, such as showing the direction of my light sources, maybe I'll add some reminders to myself to fix stuff, or just jot down ideas for additional things I can add to the painting. And personally, I think it's awesome that these instructions to myself can be visible at all time without it affecting my drawing when I use tools that use layer referencing. I went into the fill tools layer references in depth in my previous video, so be sure to check that out if you want to know more about layer referencing. The link will be in the description, of course. Auto actions. The next feature that I don't think a lot of artists used is the auto actions feature. I learned to use actions back in my Photoshop days when I edited cosplay images, and boy did it save me hours of work in the end. Basically, an auto action is a set of recorded steps that you can execute with a single click. First, open your auto actions window. If it's not visible anywhere in your interface, go up into Windows and select auto actions. Depending on which mode your default settings are set to, your auto actions might be in button mode, and then it looks like this. Or not in button mode, in which case it will look like this. The button mode is something that you can activate and deactivate in the little auto actions menu, hiding up here in the corner of the window. Button mode turns your actions into buttons that you can quickly execute simply by clicking on them. If you are in button mode, you cannot create new actions, so if you ever encounter the buttons down here being grayed out, you are probably in button mode. You probably already have some default actions when you open the window, and it's probably these. You can create your own set of actions by going to the little new set icon up here. Give your set a name and hit OK. This also automatically creates a new action for you that is now ready to be recorded. So in this example, I will create an action that creates a bunch of layers for me. Often when I color characters, I use the same layer hierarchy and names. So why not just save the time and let Clip Studio Paint do the work for me? First, I name the action by clicking on the action's current name, typing in the new name, and hit enter. Then you go down to the bottom of the window and click on the little red recording button. This starts the recording of your action. Now just perform all the steps that you wish to record. In this example, I'm creating a folder with a bunch of named layers. Just be aware that everything you do right now will be recorded, so just only do the things you want to be recorded. When you're done, click the stop recording icon. If you now fold out your action, you can see all the recorded steps. Now to execute the action, you can either turn on button mode and click on your action, or you can simply select your action and hit the play button in the bottom of your window. Now Clip Studio Paint sort of plays back your recording again and does all the steps that you just did. To create more actions, go to the bottom of the window and select Add New. You can also use auto actions to create filters for your artwork, resize your artwork for the internet, etc. The auto actions feature does have some limitations though. For instance, you can't change between tools when you're recording, and likewise, you can't change the brush size, for instance. You can, on the other hand, add all sorts of layers, including graph layers and adjustment layers. And you can also merge layers in an auto action. Record time-lapse. And lastly, a really nice feature that I was actually unaware of until quite recently, you can ask Clip Studio Paint to record your drawing time-lapse automatically. It does it in the same manner as you might be familiar with in Procreate. It saves a video step each time you lift your pencil from the tablet, so it doesn't record the entire screen or when you're like hovering with your cursor, it just records the steps happening on the canvas. When you create a new file, you can check the time-lapse option on and off. Be aware that the file size of your drawing will grow because the video info is stored inside the Clip Studio file. When you're done with your drawing, go to File, Time-lapse, and select Export Time-lapse. It is also here that you can turn time-lapse on and off. Just be aware that if you turn it off at any point in your drawing process, you will lose the video information and it cannot be restored at a later point. Export the time-lapse with the desired settings, and now you have a video file with the time-lapse of your drawing that you can share with your audience. Hooray! I'm also out of breath today. What's happening to my voice? That's it, guys. I hope you learned at least one new thing today. Remember to check out Mocha and Damon on Webtoons if you're into demon characters doing demon things. Remember to like, share, and subscribe. It's the fastest and cheapest way for you to support my work and make sure that I keep creating content for you guys. So until next time, take care. Bye!